Amen. Hold to God's unchanging hands. Hands that will never, ever get tired of holding ours. Hold to God's unchanging hands. Our scripture reading for this morning will be coming from Matthew chapter 6, beginning at verse 19. It talks about the treasures in heaven. Matthew 6, beginning at verse 19, and it reads as thus. Lay not up for yourselves treasures upon earth, where moth and rust do it corrupt, and where thieves break through and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust do it corrupt, and where thieves do not break through nor steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart be also. The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body should be full of light. But if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness? No man can serve two masters, for either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. Ye cannot serve God and mammon. Therefore I say unto you, take no thought for your life, what ye shall eat or what ye shall drink, nor yet for your body, what ye shall put on. Is not the life more than meat? And the body more than raiment? Behold the fowls of the air, for they sow not, neither do they reap, nor gather into barns. Yet your heavenly Father feedeth them. Are you not much better than they? Which of you by taking thought can add one cubit unto his stature? And why take ye thought for the raiment? Consider the lilies of the field, how they grow. They toil not, neither do they spin. And yet I say unto you that even Solomon in all his glory was not arrayed like one of these. Wherefore, if God so clothed the grass of the field, which today is, and tomorrow is cast into the oven, shall he not much more clothe you, O ye of little faith? Therefore, take no thought, saying, what shall we eat, or what shall we drink? Or wherewith shall we be clothed? For after all these things do the Gentiles seek. For your heavenly Father knoweth that ye have need of all these things. Verse 33. But seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things shall be added unto you. Take therefore no thought for tomorrow shall take thought for the things of itself, sufficient unto the day is the evil thereof. Amen. At this time, we will have one of our deacons come and lead us to the throne of grace.
Good morning. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Father, again, we come to say thank you. We come to give you the praise, the glory, and the honor, and we just thank you. We just thank you for another opportunity to be found in the house of prayer. And we thank you for all the things that have been expired so far, the discipleship classes, the leadership class, the prayer service, the inspiration service. And Lord, we just thank you. And we want to just give you the glory and the honor. Now, Father, now we come just give you worship. And just give us that worshiping experience right now, Father. And Lord, we just want to just lift up your name because you say that if we lift up your name, then you draw all men. And Lord, we want to just go out and tell a dying world what a living Savior we serve. And Lord, we just thank you. We pray for our pastor. We pray that you give him the word for your people today. And let him preach and teach with power, with authority. And preach whereas the youngest to the oldest understand, thus say the Lord. Just bless him indeed. Extend his territory. Protect him. And Lord, remember his wife. Bless her and keep her and let her continue with the women ministry and the discipleship classes and and give her the activity her limb, Father, and just strengthen her. And Lord, we just thank you for them. And Lord, we just pray for First Community as a whole, and give us that love from heart to heart and breast to breast. And Lord, there might be someone coming here today looking for a church home, or have strayed away, or have not confessed their sin. Because you say if we confess our sin, you are just and faithful to forgive us and clean us from all unrighteousness. Lord, just touch them. Let them come running down these aisles so they know that everything will live. Remember the names on the board behind me, the sick and the shut, they live away. And Lord, we just thank you for that. We just thank you for the graduate for the day in, that as they go on with their education, that you be with them. And let them keep their foundation in their hearts and their minds. And those who are looking for jobs, be with them for them. And Lord, we just want to give you the praise, glory, and honor. But Lord, but most of all, it's all because of you, that you sent your only begotten Son down here to die for us. We thank you, Lord, for when he went down in the grave and he got up with all power, and he declared a victory over sin and death. And Lord, we know you're sitting on the right-hand side of the Father right now, making intercession for us. And Lord, we just thank you. And Lord, we don't know the day and time, the season, but we do know that you're going to come back. And Lord, we just pray that you remember us and receive us in your kingdom. These blessed acts in your darling Son, I pray. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Our responsive reading will be Matthew, the 25th chapter, the 14th through the 30th verse, and in the Baptist Standard Hymn Book, page 579.
When Jesus found me,
thank you. worry about the days ahead. Jesus promised he'll take care of me.
Oh, 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 oh. Right now, praise the Jesus. Lord bless you real good, and the Lord keep you. I want to speak to us today from the gospel recorded by St. John, 13th chapter, verse 21 through verse 30. 18th chapter of John, shall we all stand for the reading of the word, please? Let us begin reading. When Jesus had thus said, he was troubled in spirit, and testified and said, verily, verily, I say unto you, that one of you shall betray me. And the disciples looked at one another, not knowing of whom he spoke. Now that I was leaning on Jesus' bosom, one of his disciples whom Jesus loved, Simon Peter, therefore beckoned to him that he should ask. He then leaning on Jesus, said to him, Lord, who is it? Jesus answered, he is to whom I shall give a sop when I have dipped. And when he had dipped the sop, he gave it to Judas Iscariot, the son of Simon. And after the sop, Satan entered into him. Then Jesus said unto him, what thou doest, do it quickly. No, at the table, he spoke this unto him. For some of them thought that because Jesus had, that he had need of for the feast, or that he should give something to the poor. Jesus then, having received the sign, went immediately out, and it was night. Thank you for your obedience. You may be seated. Judas then, having received the sop, went out, and it was night. I want to speak to us a message entitled, Put Judas Out. Put Judas Out. That Sunday, Jesus had entered into Jerusalem. Monday he had cleansed the temple. Tuesday he had conflict with the religious leader. Wednesday perhaps was a day of rest. And on Thursday he was in the upper room, with his disciples, instituting Lord's Supper, the Last Supper. And John, the beloved disciple of Jesus, the writer of the gospel, invite us into the upper room. He invites us into this upper room and to share with us the very private ministry of Jesus on this last night. What did Jesus do? What did Jesus say on this last night? What actually took place? John would have us to understand that there were some things that were pending before Jesus can go any further. And so then he shares with us the question as to who is it that shall betray man? And he goes through all of this. And we want to understand that Jesus lived under a divine timetable. No one could speed him up. No one can slow him down. No one can dictate to him what to do, when to do it, where to do it. He lived under a divine timetable. Isn't it wonderful if we can be conscious of the fact that our lives are under the control of a divine timetable? Yes. And so then we wouldn't get upset as we do. We won't be so discouraged, so full of anxiety when things don't fall in place like we wish them to, go like we wish them to, if we recognize that we are under a divine timetable. God knows exactly where we are. He knows exactly what we need. He knows exactly the kind of circumstances that we need in our lives in order to bring us from one level to another, in order to get us to where he wants us to be. He has a plan for our lives. And those of us who recognize that and submit to that plan, we can take heart to know that though the storm keep on raging or whatever happened, that we are under divine timetable, and God has a specific time for affairs to begin in our life, but he also has a specific time for those affairs, it's talking about negatively, to end in our life. So we can relax and back because Jesus has promised that he would never leave us alone. God would give us grace always to deal with whatever comes our way. The Bible teaches that God is faithful. He cannot fail. And God will never let you down. And if we submit to this, see, Jesus submitted to the divine timetable. And so he lived under a heavenly timetable. And in regards to his Father, pleasing his Father, he would do nothing outside of what his Father's will. And you notice here, if you look at John 2 and 4. John 2 and 4, the Bible says that Jesus said to her, that's his mother, "Woman, what does your concern have to do with me? My hour has not yet come." And that reading from the New King James Version. And if you look at John 7 and 30, it's recorded again. "Therefore, many sought to take Jesus, but no one laid a hand on him because his hour had not yet come." He wouldn't check out here until the hour had actually come. No man could rush his death. No man can delay his death. He was under the complete control of the heavenly timetable. And in John 8, 20, again, these words Jesus spoke in the treasury as he taught in the temple. "And no one laid hands on him, for his hour had not yet come." But then, there is a divine timetable that operates in this world, and especially in regards to the children of God and our relationship with him. And so then, when God is in control, he regulates the affairs of our lives as he did Jesus. And if you live in obedience, you will, do you hear what I'm saying? If you live in obedience, you will know to a large extent when it is time to move, when it's time to be still, when it is time to speak, when it is time to hold your peace, because God is always in control and he delights in his people and the people of his heart who put their trust in him and depend on him. Listen, you'll know to a large extent when it is time to move into the next season of your life. Some of you want to be well ahead in life right now. But you see, God knows you're not ready. He understands that, and there are some things he must do, there are some things he must let happen, there are some experiences he must allow you to go through and to face so that when you bring, he bring you into your next season, you'll know how to act, you'll get the most out of it. You'll be content and you'll be satisfied. And you won't be looking for sunshiny days all the time. You say, "Come what may, from day to day, I know that my God is with me and he's working all things out to my good." So you learn how to wait on God. You learn how to trust him even in the most adverse circumstances of your life. You learn how to wait on God. And I want you to understand that and know that, because somebody is facing this right now. It haven't happened for you in the time frame that you thought it should happen. You've been waiting a long time. You've been praying a long time. You've been trusting a long time. You put down, put out some things, put some things out of your life in preparation for God to bring you into your next season. And yet it haven't happened. Matter of fact, it looked like things are going backwards rather than forward. But don't allow that to control your feeling or to control your life. Because of the fact that God knows exactly, again, what you need. I'll show you again that Jesus lived under divine timetable. Consider John 12 and 23. When Jesus was conversing with the crowd, he said to them, but Jesus, the Bible says, Jesus answered them saying, the hour has come that the Son of Man should be what? Glorified. John 13 and 1. Now, before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour had come, that he should depart from this world to the Father, having loved his own who were in the world, he loved them unto the end. Yes, John 17 and 1, in that prayer, Jesus spoke the words, lifted up his eyes to heaven and said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son, that your Son also may glorify you. At one point in his life, he said, my hour has not come. You can't touch me. The hour has not come. You can't change the circumstances of what is taking place now because the hour has not come. You can't discredit me and you can't affect me in a negative way because my hour has not come. But when the hour came, he knew that now it was time to move about. Now it was time to move from earth to bright glory. And so the Bible says on three occasions, and Jesus knew that the hour had come. The hour had come for what? To have his own way? No. The hour had come for him, the scripture says, to glorify the Father. I submit unto you today, the hour has come for you and I to glorify God. We've been doing our things long enough. The hour has come for us to obey God in all that he has ordered for our lives. The hour has come for you to begin and for me to begin to involve ourselves more in evangelism and in discipleship. The hour has come for us to do more in raising and training our children in the way that they should go. Are you listening to me? The hour has come for us to give increase in time-wise to our prayers and the reading of the scripture and the calling on the name of the Lord. The hour has come for us to trust him for one thing and to trust him for all. The hour has come for us to stop vacillating from one place to another, one side to another, and decide that we're going to follow Jesus all the way. The hour has come for us to be faithful, to be dedicated, to be committed, and to decide whose side we're on. The hour has come for us to make the decision if we're going to be a part of the world or a part of God's holy and righteous program. The hour has come. The hour has come. As I look around and I think about it and I observe the practice of God's people, if I observe the habit of God's people, it is so unfortunate that sometimes what I see has to do with inconsistency. I'm on my post today. I'm off my post tomorrow. Somebody will help me out. That's the way I preach, y'all know that. Huh? The hour has come for us to be faithful in what we say that God has ordered for our lives. If I'm a pastor, the hour has come for me to rightly divide the word of God and to reprove, to rebuke, to instruct, to love, to encourage, to tell you when you're right, to tell you when you're wrong. The hour has come for every pastor to be honest and to think about pleasing God and not pleasing man. The hour has come for every pastor to be faithful to the word and to put God in his program ahead of everything else. But I'm not just going to pick on me today. I'm going to pick on y'all too. If you're a singer, have you noticed how sometimes we vacillate, we, up today, we down tomorrow, we on it today, we off it tomorrow. The hour has come for us to be committed and dedicated to that which we. And I'm not talking about everybody, because there are some folks I've heard talk, say over 50 words in the last 10 years. But when I look, I see them. I can count on them. They're always there, supporting that which they have made themselves a part of. Am I helping somebody? I think I'm on it this morning. The hour has come to take your post. And if you go, usher in the morning and usher in the evening. Usher when the rain is falling. Usher when the sun is shining. Deaconess, the hour has come. Deacons, the hour has come for us to be faithful to our God. Church folks, the hour has come for you to be consistent in your response to what God has ordered for your life. The hour has come for us to be faithful to God. Not come when we get ready. Not pick it up when we want to pick it up. Put it down when we want to put it down. Not half do it. Not a lackadaisically do it. The hour has come for us to honor the time that has been set to worship the Lord. If we say 8 o'clock, 8:30, 8 o'clock, and you can, you ought to be here on time. We ought not be walking around in a parking lot 9:45, giggling and laughing on ourselves, but we're already late. The time has come that we ought to honor the time that has been assigned to worship and to praise. Y'all like this kind of preaching? I know you can be somewhere else where you can hear, or you know, but this is the kind of preaching you get if you come here. Yeah, the hour has come. I know, you know, I don't be looking for it, but it just so happened that it happened so prevalently often that I just see it. Now, if I happen to go to my window and I have to just look out of the window, I see somebody 20 minutes after 10. They're standing, the doors open the car, and they're putting lipstick on. And they're proud and faithful. I mean, church started at 9 o'clock. And 20 after 10, we're still putting lipstick. The hour's come for us to be conscious of the time that we have agreed to meet God in his house. The hour, I'm preaching, y'all. The hour has come to be faithful to God. Could I make a case for faithfulness? Sure I can. God been mighty good to us. God has brought us from a mighty long way. God has raised many of us from our beds of affliction. God has gotten our children out of trouble. God has changed some of them and changed their hearts and changed their minds. The thing that used to bother us and burden us down, God stepped in. And God showed mercy and grace upon us. We could have been dead somewhere, sleeping in our graves. But God stepped in. We did some foolish things. We made some bad choices. And yet, he didn't cut us off. We're still here. We're still here. We could have been locked up somewhere. And so then, God is still here. In a day when so many are seeking position, power, prestige, and influence in the church, many are trying to glorify themselves. Jesus asked the Father to glorify your name. Whatever you do, you ought to do it for the glory of God. When God is glorified, you feel so much better that your life is worthwhile. Listen, you know that when God glorify you, see, when you glorify God, God glorify you. And when God glorify you, no man can take your glory. No circumstance and no condition can take your glory. You see, if God raised, if you raise yourself up, you're going to tear yourself down. If you let other folks raise you up, they're going to get tired of you and disgusted with you. They're going to tear you down. But if God raised you up, I don't care what comes your way. I don't care who comes your way. I don't care what Satan does. If God lifts you up, Satan, man, circumstances and conditions, situation cannot tear you down. You're going to stand. You might come out of it bloody, but you're going to stand. You might come out of it tight, full of pains, but you're going to stand. Because God lifts you up. And so then, I got a long sermon today. Yeah, I know we got to go to sleep, but I got a long sermon. No trials or tribulations can erode your glory. As you get older, watch this. When God lifts you up and God put glory on you, as you get older, from time to time, you're going to feel that you're going backwards instead of forward. As you get older, far from time eroding your glory, time will enhance your glory. You're going to get weak, but at the same time, you're going to get strong. But Paul said, though the outward man perish. You're going to get weak. Yeah, God lift you up and God put glory on you. You're going to get weak as time on. You're going to age. You're not going to walk as fast as you used to. And you're not going to be able to think and remember like you used to. That's the outward man. Don't worry about that. The outward man is going to perish. But you see the inward man, the spirit man, the knowledge of God going to increase. The joy of the Lord going to be your strength. You're going to understand that God is with you even when it doesn't seem like. And the thing that used to rally you, the thing that used to upset you, the thing that used to get you down, don't get you down no more, because you remember last time you felt that way and God came through by and by. And you remember what grandmother told you. He may not come when you want him to come, but he will always be on time. God knows when to come, how to come. He knows where to come, and he knows what to do when he comes. That's the kind of God we serve. That's the kind of God we serve. And so then, here it is, my sisters and my brothers. Verse number 31 tells us that when Judas left out, Jesus said, now is the Son of Man glorified. Jesus had told them some things while Judas was present. He had shown them some things while Judas was present. But now we got to get down qua the serious business. We got to get down to the nitty gritty. We got to get down to where the rubber meets the road now. We're about to close this earthly experience out and move into this eternal glory. And that is upon me that I had before the world begun. And because of that, now something got to change. Judas, it's all right for you to be in here when we're talking about the general thing and we're talking about the physical stuff. But now we're getting down to the heavenly business. And Judas can't be in here. Judas is not qualified. Judas is not fit. Judas is not prepared to receive the deeper things of God. And so then when Jesus was put out, Jesus said what? Now is the Son of Man glorified. Glorified because now Judas is no longer. I want y'all to understand what I'm saying. Judas is no longer present. And if we're going to share Christ's glory, then we must put Judas out. The spirit of Judas, that is. You said, Reverend, I don't have Judas in me. I'm just one person. I'm not talking about physical Judas. I'm talking about the attitude of Judas. I'm talking about the spirit of Judas. I'm talking about the perspective of Judas. You got to put Judas out. Well, what you're talking about, Reverend, what was the spirit of Judas? Here it is. First of all, Judas had a spirit of resistance. Yes. Judas resisted Jesus. He resisted Jesus' teaching. He heard everything the other apostles heard in the 3.5 years of Jesus' ministry on earth. Am I coming through and making sense now? Huh? He resisted Jesus' teaching. He heard Jesus say, if any man come after me, let him deny himself, take up a cross, and follow me. He heard Jesus say, no man can serve two masters. He heard Jesus say, you're in the world, but you're not of the world. He heard Jesus say, many worship me with their lips, and their hearts are far from me. He heard Jesus say that, but he resisted. And when he heard that, and when we hear what Jesus said, the first person we ought to look at is ourselves. To ask ourselves, if I'm worshiping with my lip, or am I worshiping with my heart? Have I taken up the cross? Have I denied myself? Am I following Jesus? You got to ask the question. We're good at critiquing others, but we need to critique ourselves. First of all, the Bible, the scripture applies to you. And applies to me personally. Yes. Judas resisted. He resisted Jesus' teaching. But also, he resisted Jesus' miracles. Uh-huh. He was there when Jesus fed the 10,000 in the wilderness. He was there when Jesus walked on the water. He was there when Jesus raised Lazarus. He resisted Jesus' teaching, and he resisted Jesus' miracles. Uh-huh. He was unaffected by what Jesus said, and he was unaffected by what Jesus did. No matter what he did, didn't affect him. You say that's sad, don't you? I say that's very sad. But is it so that we resist Jesus' miracles? He woke you up this morning. That's a miracle. He protected you on the highway. That's a miracle. He made ways for you and me where there were no ways. That's a miracle. He changed. We were on our way to hell. We had made some foolish decisions. We were on our way on the road to destruction. We were in some bad habits and had some bad practices. And we thought wrong. We couldn't stand anybody. We didn't have nothing good to say about anybody. We lied. And yet, today, we love one another. We love our sisters. We love our brothers. And our lives have changed. We no longer have to resort to artificial chemicals to make us feel good. We feel good when we read the word. We feel good when we fellowship with one another. We feel good when we pray to our Father. We feel good when we think about there is a place somewhere in glory for you and I, that there is a mansion he has prepared for us. We don't need chemistry now. We don't need chemicals now to make us feel good. We feel good. We get our joy not out of talking about other folk, but we get our joy of talking to Jesus. We no longer talk about folk. We talk to a person. We feel good. That's a miracle. That's a miracle. Look at yourself. And you had even given up on yourself. But yet God didn't give up on you. And he sent something your way. Something happened. It may have been death of a loved one. It was something that God allowed to take place in your life to open your eyes and change your perspective. That's a miracle. He could have let you drown. He could have let me drown. But he didn't. He kept me here on the land of living. I'm not going to go through all of that, but I got drunk and I ran into people's house, the man's house, and I bust up this and bust up that, demolished the car, and yet at the same time didn't have a broken bone. That was a miracle. Now the rest of you who haven't heard the story after church, you're going to be, what did I happen? Go and ask somebody else, because I'm not going to tell you no more than that. Right. Judas had a spirit of resistance, but also Judas had a spirit that refused to submit. Out of all that he saw and all that he heard, he still would not submit to Jesus. It was a spirit that refused to submit. And you know what kind of spirit that is? It was a spirit that must have its own way. A spirit that only satisfied as long as things went its way. Judas was not a team player. Other folks' ideas didn't matter to Judas. His ideas was all superior. He couldn't work well with others. He couldn't get along with others. Because it's either Judas' way or the highway. We got to put Judas out. That spirit of resistance got to be put out. That spirit failed to submit. We got to put that out of our lives. And then as I hurry on, let me move on. Thank you, Holy Spirit. I can move on a little faster. Judas, the spirit, what was it that characterized Judas? Judas loved darkness more than he did light. The message of Christ, the message of change, the message of change. And Judas did not want to change. He'd rather stay in the dark than to come to the light. You see, the light going to show you yourself just as you are. For a long time, I thought I wasn't coming over clearly. Long time, the church wasn't moving. It wasn't growing. And I'm thinking, maybe it's something about me, something about me. But the Lord made me realize that it wasn't me. It wasn't my preaching. My preaching is clear. My preaching is plain. But the Lord told me that the reason why you're not getting the response that you want and the response I want is because the people don't want to change. They don't want to learn my word because my word demands that you change. And that's why we resist his word, because his word demands that we change. Change the way we think, change the way we act, change our habits. And you know, Judah didn't want to change. And so then they would have changed if they would have accepted God's word. Judas would have changed. And so then here it is. They go to workshop, they go to seminars, they come to brother, men. Boys' conference, and they hear what the servants of God has to say, and yet they leave unwilling to change. You see, the Bible tells us that God requires that we put some things down and that we pick some things up. You have to be honest with yourself and sincere in your walk with God. You want God to show you and make known to you the things that need to be included in your life and the things that need to be excluded. Change. Change the way you use your time. Change the way you use your money. Not wholesale change all the time, but making some adjustment. And because we don't want to make adjustment in our life, we'd rather to remain the same. Change. Judah didn't want change. You see, if you're open to the word of God will change you. You see, the excuses that we use for not doing what God wants us to do, the word of God will change that. You see, the excuses we use for not coming on Wednesday night, no longer will those excuses be valid. Because every time we say, I can't, I got this to do, the Lord asks, who give you the strength to do it? I can't come because I'm tired. The Lord said, who enable you to participate in whatever activity you participated in order to get tired? I can give you a whole lot of rest, put you on your bed of affliction, put you in some intensive care, and you can get rest 24 hours a day. But yes, but I just don't want to. I just can't do this. And God said, who is it that is taking care of you? Who else are you breathing? You're able to inhale and exhale. Who give you the ability to do that? You eat every day. Who put the soil in the ground? Who give the sun the vitamin D? Who caused the rain to fall on your crop? You see, all of the excuses that we use are invalid excuses, and they don't hold up. It doesn't hold up. Because God says, it is in me. You live, you move, you have your being. And if it weren't for me, you wouldn't have what you have. I got to clean up my house. You wouldn't have a house if it weren't for the Lord. And if it weren't for the Lord, you'll have a house but wouldn't have strength to clean it up. Am I helping somebody? And if it weren't for the Lord, you would have a house and have strength to clean it up, but you won't have money to pay for the note. You ever heard of foreclosure? That's something that happened to other people. Doesn't have to happen to us, right? I'm going to leave you alone in a little while, baby. Judah's spirit was a spirit of unbelief. Judah didn't believe when he read the scripture that says, be sure, for your sins shall find you out. He didn't read the scripture and didn't believe it when it said, bring all the tithe into the storehouse. He didn't believe that. He didn't believe the scripture and didn't believe Jesus when Jesus said, every word and idle thought shall be brought into the judgment. I'm talking to y'all. We're going to have to answer for the time we spent here on earth and what we did with our lives. Did we use our time to glorify God, or did we use our time for our own gratification? We're going to have to answer that. Don't get mad with me. I won't judge nobody. But there is one who we will stand before, who knows everything. You see, you can tell me and I can tell you, well, I'm not doing this because of that and I'm not doing that because of this. I don't know whether you're telling me the truth or not. You don't know whether I'm telling you the truth or not. But there is one who knows everything. He is omniscient. And there's no excuse going to hold up before him. And I'm saying that now because what? It's better to bring your sins to the judgment than to die and let your sin bring you to the judgment. Now is the time for us to get it straight and to get it right. Thank God many of you have. Jerry Vine said this, Judas Iscariot had the life of an outward saint, but the heart of the devil. The spirit of unbelief says, I can neglect, write this, you got to get this now. The spirit of unbelief says this, I can neglect God's command. I can neglect to obey his command and still do well in life. The devil got many believing that. Jesus said, without me, you can't do nothing. If you want a good life, if you want a beneficial, fruitful, satisfied life, if you want a life that you find comfort in times of sorrow, that you find joy in the midst of your trouble, if that's the kind of life you want, if you want strength to go on, if that's the kind of life you want, submit yourself to Jesus. Give yourself to the Lord. If you want a good marriage, if you want to be a good parent, if you want to be a good servant of God, make up your mind to obey God in all things and to trust him. There are many who are taking a shortcut in life, trying to get by this and that, but it doesn't work because after I have circumvented you and after you have circumvented me, there is still one who we have to face. Do you follow what I'm saying? It's not what Ferdinand think about you, not what you think about Ferdinand, it's what God knows about all of us. And God has a great plan for our life. God loves us. He don't want to hurt us. He doesn't want to bring us down. He want to lift us up. And the only way God can bless us the way he wants to bless us, we got to obey him in all things. And nobody perfect. Nobody sinless. We're not saying that. But you got to have a heart willing to follow God. Do the best that you can. Make sure that what you're doing it from the heart. And you're sincere in what you're trying to accomplish. Yes. The spirit of Judas will lead you out of the prison. When Judas left out, he left out of the presence of Christ. And the spirit of Judas will lead you out of God's presence. It would lead you into the dark, the Bible said, and it was night. Now, John, the writer, had enough intelligence to know that the supper was being held at night, and it was dark. Why would John say to us, and it was night? He knew it was night. Everybody who read it would know it's night. But he says to us this, the life that move outside of the influence of God and the presence of God, it is always dark. That's what he's trying to say. It's dark. And in the dark, you can't find your way. In the dark, you don't know where the danger. You ever try to walk in your house? As familiar as you are with your house, if you walk through your house in dark, you're going to butt into something. You're going to stumble into something. You're going to hurt yourself. And what John is trying to communicate to us is that when we leave out of the presence of God, we are headed for hurt. We are headed for suffering. This is why it's happened. The life that leaves the presence of God goes into the dark. You see, you can take communion and still go into the dark. Judas had just received favor. Jesus had given Judas a sop. And the sop was given to the most distinguished, honored guest. Even though Jesus knew what Judas was going to do, Jesus chose to give not Bartholomew, not Andrew, not James, not John. Jesus decided to give Judas the sop. That was an act of kindness. And what Jesus was saying to Judas, Judas, I'm going to give you the sop, make you the most honored guest here. And if this does not change your mind, nothing else will. So whatever you do, do it quickly. And so then Judas' departure made room for Jesus' instruction. Having received a piece of bread, Judas then went out immediately, and it was night. So when Judas was gone out, what Jesus said, now the Son of Man is glorified. And as I close, he says to you and I, if you put Judas out, I can be glorified in your life. If you put Judas out, I can empower your singing. If you put Judas out, I can empower your preaching, preacher. If you put Judas out, I can empower what you do. And the things you touch is going to give indication that you have a divine connection. If you put Judas out, there are prayers that you've been praying for a long time I can answer for you. If you put Judas out, there are some changes that can happen in your life and your circumstances that I will bring about if you put Judas out. But my boss, it's not your boss, it's not your wife, it's not your husband. He said it's the Judas that is in you is keeping you from being raised to the next level. The Judas that is in you is keeping me from blessing you the way I want to bless you. And it's the Judas within you that keep me from opening doors for you that I want to open. It's the Judas. And if you put Judas out, I lift you up. I raise you up. If you put Judas out, I prepare a table for you in the presence of your enemies. If you put Judas out, I'll be your refuge. I'll be your strength. If you put Judas out, I'll give you everlasting joy and everlasting peace. If you put Judas out, I'll make you a mighty force to be reckoned with. I'll give you power. Well, you can effect changes in your house, changes in your family, changes in your community if you put Judas out. I use you to turn some boy or girl around. If you put Judas out, you've been praying for a change. You've been praying that young African-American men open their eyes and stop killing one another. I hear you pray that. I hear Jesus saying to the church, if you put Judas out, I'll make a difference in African-American society. I bring about the truth that I promise you, I promise to put Judas out. If my people who are called by my name will put Judas out, then shall he hear from heaven. And I'll bless that needy soul. Put Judas out and see what God does. Am I helping somebody? I think that was all right today. You're holding up yourself. I'm holding up myself. The blessed thing about that is this. Your blessing, the blessing of your family, the blessing of a community, the blessing of a church is not dependent upon what the folks on the outside does. It is dependent on what you do. And if we give ourselves to God, God will bless us and ours. And he'll put his hands on. I'm going to borrow some of them boys over there and say, if you put Judas out, God will put his hands on your finances.
Yeah.
He'll stretch your dollar.
Yes, he will.
You go in the store with $20 and come out with 5 bags of groceries and wondering how in the world you got that much. But God is a dollar stretcher. If he stretched 2 fishes and 5 loaves, he certainly can stretch Helmington, that is on there. God bless you. There may be one today. You're present. Are you present? You heard the gospel message. You may come and say, yes, I'm willing to put Judas out, but I can't do it by myself. Do you know what? God will give you grace, and he'll give you strength. God will give you everything you need to make that change, to do what you need to do. He'll give you the courage to do it. He'll give you the strength to do it. If you believe that, and God has spoken to you, you can come by letter, by Christian experience, as a candidate for baptism. Can come and allow the Lord Jesus Christ to take full control. That's what he calls for you. He calls you not so much for what you can do for him. He calls you for what he can do for you. And what he wants to do for you. He wants to take your lemon and make lemonade. You want to take those things that are bitter in your life and use them to make your life sweeter. And you can only be blessed and find peace and sweet rest. That's the only way. That's what the music is saying. As you lay it all on the altar, laying all on the altar, it's tantamount to putting Judas out. It's all depend on you. Thank God he had not left our destiny and then not left the quality of our lives in somebody else's hand. You can affect your own life in a positive way. No matter what it is, what you have done, no matter how long you have done it, nothing can hold you down if you exercise faith and ask God for forgiveness and cleansing. Nothing can keep you down. God will lift you up. I want us to understand that. Don't count yourself out because God haven't counted you out. That's hope. That was hope for Judas in spite of all of his plan. That's hope for you. That's hope for that child. Put Judas out and start praying more for that child. Put Judas out and start praying more for the black community. Put Judas out and start praying more. Start praying more for the world. And God will answer. God will answer. Sitting around the coffee table talking about it ain't going to get it done. Complaining about it not going to get it done. Pointing the finger and remembering the past. Discriminatory days. What they did to us back there in the chain. Those days are gone. It's us and God right now. I've held you and kept you long enough. The Lord bless you real good. And the Lord keep you. Make up your mind. You may be seated. Make up your mind. Make up your mind. Put Judas up. Let God do his thing. Why? Because you can only be blessed the only way. You're going to be blessed, you got to put Judas out. You're going to be blessed, you got to give up some stuff that interferes with God's plan and purpose for your life. You give him your body and soul. And so. So let's ask the question. Is your all on the altar? We're not asking if somebody else's all. We're asking if your all, if my all. We got to answer for ourselves. Have we sold out to Jesus? Are we trusting God in all things? Control. The reason why the question is so important is because you cannot. If that was a way I could be blessed some other way, I'd do it. The price is high. If that was another way, if that was an easier way, but it's not. Got to give him my body, mind, and soul. And the Lord bless you real good, and the Lord keep you. Meal for the graduates and their family in the Life Center. Shall we stand? Women ministry on tomorrow night. Let us join our hands together. Thank God for the worship experience and the fellowship this day. Thank God for you, for your coming. I preach the gospel out of love for God, loyalty to God. And I preach the gospel out of love for you. If I thought it would do you some good, if I knew it would do you some good, I'll lie to you every time I get up here. But I do know that Jesus said, you shall know the truth, and the truth shall set you free. I can't say I love you and lie to you. Thank you for where you are in Christ. Always remember, we all, pastor as well, can go higher. Love you so much, and I thank the Lord for you. Father, help us to put it all on the altar. For we know that we can only be blessed, find peace and sweet breath as we give you our body, soul, spirit. Help us to be faithful. I thank you for these, your people. Help them to know much of aspect of what they heard today.
has to do with that aspect of instruction. And so then, suffer not the devils to distort our vision and our mind. For your word is to exalt, is to rebuke, reprove, to instruct. Thank you for instruction. And you only instruct us because you want to give us more than what we have. And you want us to be found in a position where you can bless us the way you want to bless us. And all the hindrances, Judas sometimes restrict, impair, prevent, and make impossible your work in our hearts. Help us to put Judas out, that you might be glorified. This is what I ask. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. God bless you again, and the Lord keep you.